but Jesus Christ welcome tonight to Maundy Thursday, the day when we remember Jesus being with his friends, his followers, not just the 12. There were women gathered around that table that night too. And tonight, as we remember Maundy Thursday, by the way, it gets its name from the word mandate. Because Jesus said, "This commandment I give you, that you love one another." And that's the whole basis of this being called Maundy Thursday, when we're commanded by our Lord to love one another. There are some great things happening in our fellowship. The big ones tonight are tomorrow, Good Friday. It's at St. Chrysostom's. We're doing this ecumenically. So there are 5, 6, 7 churches that are part of our worship tomorrow. It begins at noon. Sally and I are giving 2 of the meditations.
And his wife's playing.
And Alice is playing. So that's also a treat. And then on Sunday, come on down at 6:15 to Orchard Beach if you're so inclined. And we worship the risen Lord and watch the sun rise as he rises in us. It's fantastic. And then we come up to the church for a light breakfast together. And I think you'll find the music and the message just, they sweep you off your feet. And of course, then we have our traditional worship at 10. I'm really looking forward to that as well. God is going to so bless whatever we do. We'll have flowers all up here thanks to Sally and all the organizing that she's done. Thank you so much, Sally. And then there's an Easter egg hunt. Mayhem will ensue. It will be glorious. I'm really looking forward to it. Tonight, our worship is going to be low tech. Those green hymnals, we're going to use those tonight. And in particular, you're going to want to mark some of the hymns. You'll see in the middle pages, we're going to sing the same hymn, but one verse at a time in between scriptures. So that's number 309. You'll want to have that open next to you, probably. Although you can sing it just out of the words here, I guess. And that's why I included them, just to make your life easier. Very good. There are other things I should have said. I haven't said yet. One more. For communion tonight, I thought it would be really great if we could all, when the time comes, rise. And we'll all come up into the chancel around the table together tonight. And pass the loaf and pass the cup together. And enjoy communion around the table in a little more intimate way than maybe we normally do. So I hope you'll be willing to come and do that. If that's not your thing and you just want to stay put, that's fine. This is not a have-to thing, right? Communion is always an if God leads you. So up to you. With that, let's begin our worship of the living God by standing and greeting each other in Jesus' name. As you return to your seats, you're welcome to remain standing for our heart opening song. I don't know if all of you know it, but there's this wonderful song called "Open the Eyes of My Heart," and I'm excited that we're going to try it. We haven't sung it in a couple of years, actually.
has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet he is seen to be stricken, smitten by God and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions, he was crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the chastisement that brought us peace, and with his wounds we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth, like a lamb that is led to the slaughter, and like a sheep that before its shearers is silent, so he opened not his mouth.
Thank you.
giving to you. You will eat and drink at my table in my kingdom. You will also sit on thrones and judge the 12 tribes of Israel.
Hymn is number 314. What wondrous love is this?
Love is this that was
It's a dirty job. Get someone else to do it. Was that what the disciples said to themselves as they went into the upper room? According to Adam Hamilton, they probably walked past a wash basin and pitcher of water. In a wealthy household, a servant would be there to wash the dirt off the feet of guests as they came in and then towel them dry. Evidently, there were no servants on duty that night, so it was do-it-yourself. But none of the disciples washed their feet as they come in. Is that a guy thing? I don't know. Maybe. But it might also be that no one stopped to do it because they didn't want to get stuck doing it for everyone else. After all, if Jesus was coming into his kingdom, well, there were positions of power to be had. That night, the disciples argued about who was going to be greatest in the kingdom. Was it John and James, the sons of Zebedee, called the sons of thunder? Or was it their mom who asked if they could sit on Jesus' right and left when he comes into the kingdom? Or maybe it was all of them. No one wanted to be the one to have to wash everyone else's feet. It's a dirty job. Get somebody else to do it. It's a dirty job. But someone's got to do it. That's what Jesus wanted his disciples to understand. As no one willingly took up the basin and the towel, humanity has always run on self-interest. Didn't the great economist Adam Smith say that thrift, hard work, and enlightened self-interest were the keys to the market economy? In his book, The Wealth of Nations. And he's right, of course. Everyone acts in their self-interest, at least some of the time. And so people seek profit and power, comfort and experience. In that world, the dirtier the job, the less folks want to do it. So when I was a kid, I remember sitting around this enormous table with my older cousins. And at some point in the meal, my aunt would very slyly put a finger to the side of her nose. And then one by one, my cousins would also slyly put a finger to the side of their nose. And the last one to notice, the last finger to go to the side of the nose, they were doing the dishes. As someone too young to play that game, I thought it was hilarious. But there were 12 of us around that table. So maybe it wasn't as funny for the person who got stuck with it. Our world works a little bit like that, doesn't it? It's like we're all sitting around an incredible table, and if we have enough money or enough privilege, we get to put the finger on the side of our noses. And if we don't have enough money or privilege, then we start to scramble so that we are not that person who has to do the dirty job. So we shouldn't downplay how world-shaking what Jesus does next is. He gets up from the table. He pours water in the basin. Ties a towel around his waist and kneels before each of his followers to wash their feet. So Jesus, the Son of God, kneels before those he came to save. Jesus, the one who could still the storm, heal the sick, raise the dead, takes the dirtiest job that. In Mark Jesus says of himself, the Son of Man came to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many. It's a dirty job. Someone's got to do it. And Jesus did. It's a dirty job, but we will share it together. Perhaps that's the extraordinary point of the Last Supper. Jesus and his followers weren't gathered in the upper room for the Last Supper. They were gathered in the upper room to celebrate the Passover. They were remembering how God rescued the Hebrew people from slavery in Egypt and protected them from a final awful plague by killing a lamb and painting their doorposts and lintels with the lamb's blood, so that the angel of death would pass over. For Jews, still that meal is more than a symbol. It is a way of participating in the reality of that first Passover night, now more than 3,000 years ago. They eat the same kinds of foods that the Hebrew people ate that night, and they relive the story. And Jesus started something new that first Maundy Thursday that we will remember again tonight. As Jesus broke the bread and poured the cup, he talked about how it was his body broken for them, his blood poured out for them. Jesus talked about how this was the start of a new promise, a new covenant relationship that would continue on into the future. Perhaps they were confused, Jesus' friends, but after the crucifixion, they realized what Jesus had done had changed their world. From then on, whenever they gathered, they remembered Jesus' words. They remembered what Jesus did. And it wasn't just a memory or a symbol for them. It was happening. They were experiencing that first Thursday night. In some mysterious way, that first Maundy Thursday was happening to them. And they could participate in that original moment around the table. In a life that can be so hard, with difficult choices, even real suffering, Jesus begins a practice with us that reminds us we will never be alone. It's a dirty job, but we will share it. It's a dirty job, and I'll do it for you. That's not quite what Jesus prayed in the garden, is it? With all his closest followers, it was not just the 12. Jesus went to the Mount of Olives, and that night may be the only time Jesus asked his followers to pray for him, to pray with him. He knew the road ahead. And he needed to get things sorted out, so he went a little ways apart with Peter, James, and John. And then the battle really began. Prayer is a battle. That's not how we usually think of it. But history came to a pivot point that night. How the next few hours went would determine all of human history going forward and the meaning of all the history that had been. Adam and Eve had a similar point in another garden long before. For Eve and Adam, they believed eating from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil would make them like God. Though it did open their eyes to the way the world works, it just shows how little they understood God. In sharp contrast, Jesus, who clearly doesn't want to go through with the crucifixion, comes to understand that God is prepared to go to any length to show each person his love for them. I wonder, did the last 33 years come crashing in on him that night? Heaven came down to earth as God took on flesh when Jesus was born, full of grace and truth, asking questions and teaching in the temple as a teenager, enduring temptations in the desert, healing and teaching in synagogues, on the streets and in the temple. And now is Jesus' final test. By choosing to eat the fruit, Adam and Eve essentially said to God, "My will, not yours, be done." Praying in the Garden of Gethsemane, Jesus prays, "Not my will, but yours be done." Adam and Eve's act is very much in their self-interest. Jesus' choice is very much a sacrifice in all of our interest, in the interest of the whole world, in fact. Where Adam and Eve's choice brings brokenness into the world, Jesus' choice brings healing and restoration. It's like Jesus might have said, "It's a dirty job, and I'll do it for you, God." But tonight, of all nights, we are reminded that Jesus resolved to accept death on a cross, not only out of love and obedience to God, but out of love and hope for us. And so Jesus says to each of us tonight, being crucified is a dirty job, and I did it all for you. May it be so. Communion hymn tonight. It's written by some of the folks that we've come to really love their songs. Ben Glover plays for the Sidewalk Prophets. David Crowder has a fantastic band. Matt Nager. He wrote this very sweet song, "Come As You Are." Let's stand as you read.
Forever you've been, a broken heart in the rescue.
be seated. That sense that we are not only invited to come as we are, but can, is a remarkable thing, a sign of the grace of God being around us. It used to be you had to jump through hoops to do communion. This church doesn't believe like that. This church believes Jesus is inviting anyone to this table who just wants more of him. It's not my table. It's not this church's table. It is Jesus' table. And you are welcome to come, whether you're part of this church or another church, even no church at all, simply longing for more of this Jesus who we remember tonight. Coming to the table is not a have-to thing. It's an if-you-want-to thing. If it blesses your life, if it fills you up more, if it draws you in, then come to the table and find this Jesus in whose footsteps we long to walk. Amen. In your bulletins, you'll find a prayer of confession. I always do better reminding myself how humble I am before God before communion comes. I hope it's the same for you. Could we come humbly before our God? Let's pray. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart, and we have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen. Dear friends, Jesus knows that we are flawed human beings, and still he loves us. How can that be? And yet it is. I want you to hear the good news of tonight, the good news of the table and the tomb and the empty tomb. Jesus came to save, and in Jesus Christ we are forgiven. Amen. I'd like to invite those of you who would like to come forward for communion to come on up and around the table tonight. Thank you. it to his friends, he said, "This is my blood shed for the forgiveness of your sins." The new covenant, a new promise, a new witness to what God can do in your lives. Whenever you drink this cup, remember me. For as often as you eat this bread and you drink this cup, you show forth my death until I come again. Isn't it a mystery that the one who is broken is the one who makes us whole? Isn't it a mystery that the one who emptied himself has enough? Fill us up. These are the gifts of God to the people of God. So we are going to pass the bread as you offer to the next person. As you offer to the next person, say, "The body of Christ broken for you," to that person. Okay?
We're the same in number.
Are we really?
I was just doing the count. I was trying to get back to the front of the room. I just kept counting the whole room. The body of Christ broken for you.
So if you've got a teeny tiny piece, you may want to get something a little bit bigger, though. I know we're using our little cute things. We're going to dip it tonight. And so if you don't have enough, you're going to get your thumb in the drink, and that's probably not good for any of us. Miles and Doug, you can just... So now, we're going to dip just the bread, not your thumb, just the bread, and as you give it to the next, you hold the cup for the next.
to him and gave him strength. In his anguish, he prayed more earnestly, and his sweat became like great drops of blood falling down on the ground. When he got up from prayer, he came to the disciples and found them sleeping because of grief. And he said to them, "Why are you sleeping? Get up and pray that you may not come into the time of trial."
And while he was still speaking, suddenly a crowd came, and the one called Judas, one of the 12, was leading them. He approached Jesus to kiss him, but Jesus said to him, "Judas, is it with a kiss that you are betraying the Son of Man?" When those who were around him saw what was coming, they asked, "Lord, should we strike with the sword?" And then one of them struck the slave of the high priest and cut off his right ear. But Jesus said, "No more of this." And he touched his ear and healed him. Then Jesus said to the chief priests, the officers of the temple police, and the elders who had come for him, "Have you come out with swords and clubs, as if I were a bandit? When I was with you day after day in the temple, you did not lay hands on me. But this is your hour, and the power of darkness." special night, we have had the amazing presence of Jesus in our midst. And as his Spirit has moved in us, could we pray for us as we go? The unison prayer of benediction that you'll find in your bulletins. Let's pray.